This is the MLW Radio Network.
Welcome, everybody, to the Mind of the Meanie, your weekly peek into the world, according to former WWE superstar and ECW original, the Blue Meanie. We'll cover wrestling, music, movies, sports, and lots of useless knowledge, all contained in the Mind of the Meanie. I am your tour guide, Josh Shernoff, and he is the Blue Meanie. Meanie, what's on your mind?
It's 5830 time, or 38.
There we go. Yeah, we sent out a little message ski to our Patreon members who are here joining us live right now on a Friday evening, and
Friday night
titled it episode 38, which it's not. It's episode 58. It's episode 5838. Title of the show. How's it going,
off to a the show's off to a rounding start.
Well, if it was rounding, it would be episode. We would just call it episode 60 at this point.
Yeah, but. And then I tried to do a 5150 ode to 5150, and I botched that. So,
well, I got
this show's gonna be awesome.
Yeah, it's gonna be the shit. But so, how's everything going? What's up, man? What do you have on the TV?
Well, shit, I'm waiting for the draft to start. Night two, mm-hmm. Watched night one last night.
Were you happy? Were you satisfied?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because, like, I mean, we got, you know, this quarterback, Jalen Hurts, who really never really got a chance. Like, COVID wiped out all the preseason.
Right.
Then everything happened with Carson. Then they bring in, they bench Carson for Jalen for the last four games. Mm. And you really have nothing to base him on, because those are basically his preseason
games. Yeah, right.
You know, once you go from college to NFL, the speed of the game changes, you know? So, with that said, last night, the Eagles in the first round took Devontae Smith, who played 2 years at wide receiver with our current quarterback, Jalen Hurts. So, that's exciting to see them reunite. They played in Alabama, Roll Tide. What's up, Conrad? I texted Conrad. He knows all the time. I don't know if he's happy about that. But I was like, oh, we got Devontae Smith. But, yeah, it's cool, man. And tonight I'm hoping they take the kid from, Notre Dame. There's a defensive guy from Notre Dame I really like. Kind of reminds me of they're showing the highlight reels of him hitting people, and they all remind me of Brian Dawkins on Andre Crumpler in the 2004 NFC Championship game.
Oh, geez.
Here's the thing. Like, the morning of yesterday's draft, WIP here in Philly, this local sports station, they're playing an audio clip of Devontae Smith saying, hey, I'd love to, you know, play with Jalen again, and playing in Philly would be second to none. We're all like, is he petitioning to come here? So today, the kid from Notre Dame, not today, but I saw an interview today where he's like, yeah, man, I'd love to play in Philly. I'm just like, oh.
There you go.
I got the bubble guts, you know, like. Like the kind you get when the second cup of coffee kicks in, and you're like, oh, bloop, I got to go to the bathroom.
To put in perspective for, let's say, wrestling fans who aren't really familiar with, you know, last season's Eagles, talking about, like, Hurts, it would be like imagine back when you were in WWF, and you're doing some of the schools, like, you were down there training with, like, Dr. Tom, right? You're doing that. Some of that stuff.
The Funkin' Dojo.
Yeah. And you're doing that, but you're not working TV, let's say, right? You're just doing that, and you're there, you're getting your reps in. And then they're just like, hey, Meanie, listen, Triple H is out. We need you. You're working Rock main event Raw tonight. and you're like, I haven't been out in front. I haven't worked a match outside of the Funkin' Dojo. And, you know, I feel like it was like a lot of that of like, hey, you know, you've got your talent. It's not like this is the first time you've ever, you know, stepped on the field or stepped in the ring. But holy crap, man. Right? Like, like all of a sudden, it's just like he's just been sitting and hanging out. Obviously, he's in practice. He's doing it. But then he pops out. Like, you're not going to get what hopefully you're going to get this go around.
Right. I think with the proper off season and preseason games, now that everybody's getting vaccinated and they're going to have people in the stands, I don't know if people will be able to go to practice and stuff like that. Or, like, they used to have the thing where the fans could come to, a couple workouts.
Right.
But I think with a proper preseason, getting some proper snaps and some preseason games, I like this new coach, Nick Sirianni.
Yeah, that's going to be – that's I think, going to be the biggest
– Yeah.
The biggest thing to wait and see about.
Yeah. Everybody who Nick Sirianni has worked with has – nothing but praise for him. So we'll see, man. He used to be a wide receiver, and he was a wide receiver's coach. Now we got people are like, oh, well, you got the second, but I think we got the best one. And everybody judges people on how fast they can run a 40, but whatever. But I seen this kid's footage, and he just breaks ankles. And, like, the guy's trying to tackle him, and he goes one way, and they go the other way, and snap.
You know, I like to think if I was in his position, I would be breaking my ankles very quickly as well.
So, but it's cool, man. And, like I said, we're doing this Friday night, and might break protocol and put the TV on in the background just to see what happens. Here's some good fucking heel pro wrestling shit, right?
Yeah.
So the Eagles, you know, there's a big hullabaloo about the Eagles potentially tanking the last game of the season last year so they could get the 6th-round pick. Yeah, I don't give a shit. You know, the season sucked anyway. Were you going to win one moral victory? Yeah. So,
hey, for those who didn't see the motion that Meanie did, we're not on Fight. If you want to see it, join patreon.com/mindofthemeanie. Just wanted to throw that out there. We're back to Patreon. There he is again. Oh, man.
Hey, Slichter, make a gif of this, please. So when the Eagles tanked that game, the last game against the Washington football team, it essentially knocked the Giants out of the playoffs. So Giants fans were in a fucking uproar because they were hoping the Eagles would win.
Right.
So the Giants could get into the play, you know, with the records and all that stuff. Yeah. So Eagles have the 6th-round pick. They trade back with Miami. They go to 12. In return, Miami gives the Eagles a 1st-round pick for next year. Mm-hmm. So next year, the Eagles have potentially 3 1st-round picks.
Man, if they chose to tank that game... That was the long con there, not to be confused with the Tony con, who also did very well.
Yes, he did very well.
Sean Jones says though, that Bears had the steal of the 1st round. Your thoughts on that, Meanie?
Well, we'll see what happens. Yeah, you still have the same coach, so. The point I'm trying to get, the pro wrestling skullduggery here. So the Eagles tank. They knock the Giants out of the playoffs. Giants bitch about it. Eagles trade back from 6 to 12, which put them in a position for it to be Cowboys, Giants, Eagles, 10, 11, 12. So the Cowboys won it. I can't think of the name of the dude, but the Broncos wind up taking him. So the Cowboys were out in that guy. So the Eagles wanted DeVonta Smith. The Eagles also knew the Giants wanted DeVonta Smith. So the Eagles contacted the Cowboys, and they swapped places. So the Eagles traded a 3rd-round pick and got ahead of the Giants and took the wide receiver the Giants wanted. And it's like I've been watching giant fan reaction videos all day. So that's,
you know, and that's, I mean, clearly not for the Giants fans, but for, but in general, this is why the, this is why watching this is so much fun for people.
Yeah.
Because it really is that, like, that kind of behind the scenes story, you know, which we all love that stuff. And, you know,
yeah.
But, no, that's awesome. I think,
so, yeah, it was pretty fun. It was pretty fun. And there should be some interesting games at Giant Stadium this year. You know?
Yeah, well, just reigniting the rivalry. Not that it needed any reigniting, but
it kind of went stagnant. Like
it did. Yeah, it really did need to piss them off a bit.
When football's the best, is when everybody in your division's good. You know, so there's that tension to it.
That was not last year.
No.
that was the antithesis of last season.
Yeah. Yeah, it was. The Eagles, Washington, Dallas, and the Giants are in the NFC East, which everybody dubbed the NFC Least. So, I'll say one thing: Washington's getting really good, which is kind of scary. Mm-hmm. But hopefully, the NFC East gets back to prominence to what it used to be, because the NFC East used to run football back in the day. You know, between the Giants and the Cowboys and the Eagles and Redskins, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm going to get if the anytime Washington beats the Eagles, I get, or is just doing well in general, I get the text from a buddy from high school who's just a long time fan of the Washington football team. As they're known now. And there's just that little rivalry, that he would always just, you know, love them. And we would just love to shoot him a text even 20 years later. But, but listen, that's enough about me and my high school friends that nobody knows about nor cares about. So I don't want to go into that. Hey, send all your reviews to, go on iTunes and give us a nice 5-star review if you would. And send your hate tweets to @SoSaysSchernoff. It's better. Send the hate tweets directly to me. You know, don't leave them in a review. You're when you hurt me, Meanie hurts too. And when you do it that way, and you don't want to hurt the Meanie.
Meanie's got ouchies.
Yeah, it's not fun at all. But so.
Now that we've lulled everybody to sleep with football talk.
Yeah. Here's something we can talk TV and wrestling all in one, because I just read that Young Rock has been picked up for a second season.
That's awesome, man. Yeah. I love that show.
That's really cool.
It's good.
Because I know Dwayne Johnson's like the biggest star in Hollywood, but watching that, I've consistently had this feeling of like, does anyone who doesn't know wrestling like this? You know, like I've really, like, cause I can't look at it as an outsider, you know, looking in. So to me, I'm sitting there and I'm seeing the Wild Samoans and you're seeing Junkyard Dog and, you know, and I'm getting hot about Macho Man because he's the one casting I'm not really thrilled about, but you know, but I'm always wondering to myself, like, you know, when I see Junkyard Dog, that means something to me. But even somebody who's like a casual wrestling fan nowadays may not even remember or have ever heard of Junkyard Dog, you know?
Right.
So it's I don't know. I'm always just wondering, maybe they just look at it and say, hey, it's just characters on TV, right? And it's just done in a fun way. But
I hopefully I pitch this. Hopefully they do it. Probably won't. But, Rock's from the Lehigh Valley area. They do a lot of stuff in the Philly area. They did the one show where Rock was in Philly. I want to see a crossover episode with Young Rock and the Goldbergs, where the Goldbergs go to a match at the Spectrum, and Young Adam sits with Young Rock. That would be all like next.
That would be really cool. I think they're different. Yeah. Are they? They're different networks, aren't they? NBC and ABC. But yeah.
I've looked for examples where this has happened, and it's happened where like shows cross promoted on different networks and stuff like that. It's rarely happened, but it's happened.
I feel like if there's anyone who can make a phone call, make that happen, it's The Rock.
Yeah, if the Goldbergs want The Rock on their show.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so yeah, that would be awesome. And yeah, shout out to them and Brian Gewirtz.
Mm-hmm.
He's working hard on that show too. They were filming in Australia, which is amazing because it looked just like any neighborhood in you know, the Philly area, or America, you know.
Hey, Philadelphia, so really cool. It's the Australia of Pennsylvania.
Like Bill Apter is the George Napolitano of.
Hey, speaking of Bill Apter, did you see his post on social media? I remember months ago he posted a picture of him and Jerry Lawler in his driveway. Was like, and they both had their like mask. Like, well, I don't know if Lawler had a mask. That's a story for another day. But Bill had his mask and everything. And I was like, wow, okay, so this picture is like current. And I was like, hey, thanks for the call, Bill. But he posted this picture. It was Jerry Lawler, Ben Brown, the archivist, the dude, I can't remember his name, but the one who's kind of like, not exactly the host, but kind of driving along the WWE Lost Treasures or Hidden Treasures or whatever, that I can't remember the name of the show, but love the show, but I'm so focused on the show I didn't even grab the name. But yeah, they're all there. They're all they were all at Bill's house, and apparently this week on A&E, Apter's Alley may make an appearance on.
That's so cool that they're including Bill on it, you know.
I'm really curious of what he has of Jerry Lawler's, because it's the Jerry Lawler episode. And I know, like, they're talking about the treasures, but I've been down in Apter's Alley. I got my start back in the business doing this type of stuff down in Apter's Alley. And Bill has some incredible, incredible memorabilia down there.
The host is AJ Francis.
Yes, okay.
Yeah,
I couldn't remember his name. Seems like a dude you'd want to hang out with.
He wears a Job Squad shirt in one of the episodes, so he's over.
Oh, then he's the best. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's awesome. But it's really like I'm excited to see what it is. I didn't even want to ask Bill what
it's got to be. Can I make a prediction?
Please.
It's got to be something like Andy Kaufman or something like
it's
that.
It has to be, but I'm trying to think of what it is because Bill has shown me everything down there. Let me rephrase that. Bill has taken me down to Apter's Alley. That doesn't sound much better, but the only stuff that I can remember that he has there from Jerry Lawler is Bill's daughter Haley's bat mitzvah. Jerry drew like all of the decorations, like drew all these caricatures of her. And has those in the house still, but I feel like that's not something that Triple H and Stephanie are calling for. Hey, King, we know once upon a time.
Shit, Bill just gave me ice cream. I didn't go down to Apter. I didn't get take a trip down to Apter's Alley, you know?
Have you never been to Apter's Alley?
No, I want to.
Oh, you have to. When everything's back to normal, you got to go down there, and then he'll take you into the back room, and he'll do a little karaoke for you. That's a shoot, as they say.
On a second thought, he's been threatening to buy me some burnt pizza. So or whatever.
Take him up on it.
Yeah. Take a little ride on up. So here's my phone bill from when I called Andy Kaufman. I called Jerry Lawler with Andy Kaufman, and Andy Kaufman signed the phone bill or something like that.
Yeah, I'm really curious what it is, and I know telling tales. I wonder
if he still has Andy Kaufman's phone number. That'd be great.
If he's
I'm
sure he does. He's got a he has down there a Rolodex. Like a legit. Old school Rolodex, and I haven't thumbed through it because I felt like that was probably inappropriate. Yeah, I'm sure he's got that on there. But you know,
I'm going to text him on his rotary phone.
Yeah. he'll tell you that you need to call after 7 or something when it's cheaper. No, he's. I know he's got some stuff down there that I think, you know, rumor and innuendo is that Conrad has expressed some interest in some of the things that that Bill's got down there. And Bill, the thing is, it's tough for Bill to part with some of these things. Because unlike a lot of the people that you see on the shows who are like collectors, and I know they're emotionally attached to it, but these collectors that, you know, they got it at an auction or they got this or that. A lot of what Bill has, like Bill has, you know, Mil Máscara masks that Mil Máscara gave to me, his Rey Mysterio masks that Rey gave to him or gifted to his son. And like, he's got all of these things that were, they were like gifts from the people as opposed, you know? So I know he's attached to it, and I was able to broker a deal between him and Matt Cardona a couple of years ago for a Hasbro ring that he got at the Hall of Fame. It was one of the it had like the Hall of Fame sticker on it. Like, they didn't sell these. It was just something that was on as a centerpiece in the tables of an early Hall of Fame when they used to be like the banquet dinners.
Yeah.
And he always had it. I'm like, man, I'm like, that's pretty cool. So I posted a picture of it, and I was like, man, we got all kinds of great things in the in Apter's Alley down here. And Cardona slid into my DMs. It's just like, what am I looking at here? Because I don't remember that. So, but Vanessa Bello asking, any progress on a possible Chella figure of Bill Apter? So I did a soft introduction. First I spoke to Bill. I said, hey, Meanie and I basically planned out like a 6-series, you know, set of you. Bill was very interested and very appreciative of all of you in the pod squad who thought that would be a cool idea. And then I said, well, let me reach out to Chella. I reached out to Chella Toys, and they said, we are more than interested to have a conversation with Bill. So I shot out an email of, hey, you know, Bill, meet this one, meet Bill. And that's it. And I'm out, you know, they can take it from there. They're all grown ups. And, but so I've made that connection, and I would imagine, I can't see how they wouldn't come to a deal. Having Meanie and I, having worked with Chella, they're so great to work with that. Like,
so easy.
And Bill is such an easygoing guy to work with too. And you know, there's no egos in this scenario. So I would be shocked if we don't eventually end up with a Bill Apter, Chella Toys, wrestling megastar, which will be in my office, front and center. So hopefully that happens sooner than later.
Dude, that's so cool. That's so cool. That would be awesome to have like a Bill Apter. Like I said, I want the ringside photographer with the T-shirt and the
that was, you know, the,
like, have you? What's that?
No. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off there.
Oh, you know, like how you have the mic. You can kind of use the whatever it is for the mic to make it look like he's holding the camera or something like that. That'd be awesome.
He didn't. That was the one thing he was kind of like, I don't know if I want the old T-shirt look. That was like the one era he didn't want. Bill was kind of torn between, do we do modern day Apter's Alley gray hair, one piece combed over Bill, or do we do dark hair, like early to mid 90s Bill with the camera around ringside? Although I still think the big seller is the one of him with the plaque, like right off of you know, JCP, like right off of that, you know? No, JCP.
That'd be great.
Yeah, JCP.
Jim Crockett promotion.
Yeah, I'm a JTP is what was, I thought I was saying JTP, like from the Goldbergs. That's what I was trying to, yeah, but no, I was right.
Same neighborhood, right?
But yeah, so what else is going on, man? What else is, you check, oh, man, you catch just, the Roddy Piper?
The Roddy Piper documentary was not only awesome, but I'm watching it and they show a photo of Piper and Flair hugging. I go, oh my God, I know that photo. It's like, holy shit. So I run down, I call it my Mark book, you know, from when I was a kid and stuff like that. And I start flipping through it. They show a photo, Piper and Flair hugging, and the photo was taken maybe a couple seconds after a photo I took of in the same situation, which was crazy. Amazing. So I went on my all my social medias and I posted the A&E still and this the photo mm-hmm. that's still inside my book. So
yeah, there's no question. I mean, it's not like there's no interpretation by somebody is 100% like seconds, milliseconds even apart from each other.
Yeah, I still got
is that your mark book?
Yes, yeah, my mark book. I got on my let me see. Yep, there it is right there. Just oh, and Bobby Heenan was there too, and Ted DiBiase.
Oh wow. Hold up. Oh man.
DiBiase, there's Heenan and Flair, and Flair's looking through his briefcase. And then this is the shot.
Yeah.
Flair and, oh, I don't know directions. Flair and Piper hugging. And then there's Piper and Arn Anderson.
Yeah.
That was down at the airport Marriott.
Wow. And you can see these photos if you go to patreon.com/mindoftheMeanie and watch this video. Yeah, I'm really pushing that Patreon today.
It's me and Shawn Michaels.
Whoa, I've never seen that picture before. That's fantastic.
Same night Ricky Morton was there.
What a... Dude, you had to have been losing your mind.
Dude, I was so fortunate to grow up in, you know, amongst the Philly wrestling crew.
Did you ever have any other night like that? Where it was... Because they were both in town, so...
That was a rare head-to-head. They had done one in 86. That was November 17th, 1991. I had to look it up.
But I'm just saying, 1991.
My memory's not that good.
In 1991, like, how often are you taking a picture with Shawn Michaels and Ricky Morton in the same? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. Actually, it might have been 1990. Okay.
Well, 1990, you were doing it all the time. But yeah, 91 would have been impressive.
Yeah. No, but that was cool. It was cool. And, well, it was actually, I had a similar moment like that where, Sherri Martel was, I was at the same hotel, WWE was in town, I took a photo with Sherri Martel, and then later I, become friends with Donnie B and Nova, mm-hmm. and they were showing me their mark photos, and they have a photo of her in the same address, in the same outfit, she's wearing this black dress, in the same hallway.
Oh, wow.
So, somewhere along the line, me, Nova, and Donnie B were all in the same room and never even realized it, just hanging out, being fans.
So the crazy thing is, what she didn't realize was that she actually was in that hallway taking pictures with 2/3 of the BWO. Looking back, would have been a career highlight for her, I'm sure.
I wound up having a mixed tag with her eventually down the line.
When was that?
My friend Jack Cott. Oh my God! I want to say year 2000, somewhere in the summer of 2000. My buddy Jack Koshek, who is Dave Hero's cousin.
Dave Hero, shout out to him. Great guy.
Yeah, great guy.
Great guy. He is a big guy.
Yeah, he could have been a wrestler. Yeah. But his cousin Jack would run the Milwaukee Metal Fest, and they would have metal bands, but in between bands. Breaking down and setting up, they would have a ring in the middle of the mosh pit and they would have people wrestling. And, did a mixed tag with her and, she was always cool to me. Sherri was the best. Cause later on that night we were signing, autographs out in the lobby.
Yeah.
And there's a bunch of, everybody's drunk and there's guys who are wrestling fans and guys who aren't. And there's like this drunk guy coming over. And he's like looking at my 8x10s, and I'm just looking at the beer in his hand, and it's it's going. The water's going back and forth in his cup, like waves on the ocean. I'm like, dude, please don't spill your beer on my 8x10s. And he's not listening, so I had to give him one of those bro shoves, right? Oh, and he stumbled backwards a little bit, and he acted like he was going to come fight me. And Sherri stood up and got shoulder to shoulder with me, like we were going to throw hands with these metalheads,
That's so awesome.
Yeah, so that was pretty cool. Yeah, Sherri's the best, man. I miss her.
I do want to say Jack Koshek.
Jack Koshek.
That's it. I remember I'm friends with Dave Hero on Facebook, and so his cousin Jack has actually been going through some rough times, some medical issues, and they have a GoFundMe set up for him. So we're gonna go ahead and I'll do it tonight as we record this, so you'll already see it up there on our social media. But maybe we'll go give that a little tweet.
And hey, you know what? If you see us post it on our socials, go on GoFundMe, look up Jack Koscheck.
Yeah,
Koshik.
I-C-K.
Any amount helps.
Yeah,
$5. $10, $1, who cares? It's something.
It's something, so. Yeah. But I just, as soon as you said his cousin Jack, it just flashed in my head. I've seen him post stuff and kind of been following along, and I know he's heading to a rehab facility a little bit. His kidneys are having some issues still, and I know he had successful surgery, but
he had heart surgery. He had like four valves.
I think he's just kind of having some effects from that, but hey, you know, send in our best to cousin of a friend. So
dude, I really love Jack Koscheck. He's the reason why sorry, shit. He is the reason why I had my tag team match with Screech from Saved by the Bell. That was one of his shows. Besides the Milwaukee. Well, Jack Koscheck was a well-known concert promoter in the Midwest.
And a local promoter, apparently, for WWF back in the day.
Yes.
Back in the day, yep. Yeah.
So he would always have some kind of, him and Dave always have some wrestling thing. So there was like 2 years in a row, they had wrestling after the local hockey game. Mm. They would have to, it was like a, I forget what division, it was minor league, but they would have the hockey game, and then they would have the ring suspended over the ice, and they would just slowly lower it down.
It's so cool.
It is. And the 1 year I wrestled Al Snow, which was awesome. One of the few times we worked one-on-one, which was insane. I mean, we had, like, practice matches, but as far as being on shows, we've always been, like, a tag team. And then the next time it's supposed to be a mixed tag, me and someone who shall not be named, we're supposed to wrestle Luna and Gangrel, and that person didn't show up. So Jack was kind of representing Screech as in a managerial role, kind of like, you know, handling his bookings and stuff. And they're like, oh, yeah, you're going to tag with Screech. I went, what? Cool. Yeah. And like for like 2 hours before the show, I'm like, okay, here's what you could do. And I showed them stuff, and we got together with Gangrel and Luna, and they were awesome with, well, like, Luna beat the shit out of me, but, you know. Hey, Luna, hit me. Luna, I want you to punch me square right in the face. Why, Meanie? Because your working punches are killing me. God bless her. I love Luna. But, Jack, and then, you know, that eventually I became a question in Trivial Pursuit because of that. So, yeah, if you can give Jack Koscheck a little love on, you know, the GoFundMe.
And even if you don't have any money to donate, just
share
tweet
it
out.
Link.
Share it out. Yeah, share the link. That's just as helpful, if not more so, you know?
Absolutely. He's a good dude, man. There's some stories I can't even tell because it might even actually get him heat. No, I'm just kidding.
I've never met him, but I have had the pleasure of working with Dave a ton of times. Now David Hero is a good dude, so any friend of his, you know, or I guess family of his.
My favorite Jack story is he was at Al Snow's wedding, and it was like, one of Al Snow's weddings. the second to last. And it was like half wedding, and they're like coming to Halloween costume, and Jack Koscheck came as like disgruntled Batman. He was just like, he was Batman, but he had like a beer, like he had alcohol in one hand, like Batman smoking, like, what are you, yeah, he was totally playing up the character, so that was cool.
That's awesome.
I could tell a story, but it's such a cool story that I don't even know if they want me to share it, so I won't share it. I said it would get him heat. It won't get him heat, but it's a story I don't know if he wants shared. So I'm going to respect his privacy on that one.
All right. Well, hey, maybe at some point when he kicks out of the province.
I'll tell you off air, but
yeah. What's that?
I'll tell you off air, but yeah, it's a that's it's a good one.
Gives our listeners another reason to hate me. So oh man,
I got theories on that, but
on why sure. they hate on why they hate me.
It might be a work. I don't know. But yeah.
Wait, what?
That's as far as I'll tell you off air.
Okay.
I've been meaning to tell you for like a week. You told me that thing. This is great content, by the way.
Yeah. Hey, you told me that thing. You know, we're not going to talk about it. Don't mention what it is. But yeah, you told me a thing, and I was like, nobody's listening. I got to tell him this thing. And then I didn't tell you that, but we talked about that other thing. But when we were doing that other thing, you should have said the one thing.
Yeah.
Here we go. I'm writing it down. We should
do a whole show like that. Yeah.
Writing down.
I have a theory.
The thing. All right. I'm curious now.
Theory.
You know what?
I
can't wait. All right. This has been the Mind of the Meanie. We'll see you next Monday. All right, Meanie, we're off the air.
It was Colonel Mustard in the library.
The candlestick.
Very lovingly.
Arch. So,
yes, dear.
I had a busy week, had a visitor come by my house.
Oh, yeah, did you?
Yeah. The Blue Meanie. Blue Meanie came by the house, and my kids basically attacked him, and I have a nice picture of...
I felt like Hulk Hogan in a Real American Video. When
swarming.
The kids on the chopper, on the motorcycle.
My son's giving you like hugs and kisses and also collar and elbow tie ups, and it was great,
dude. He throws a pretty good lockup.
He is
how old is he?
He just turned 4 last week.
Wow,
he's a strong little dude too. But shooter. He is bless you. He
sometimes I forget I'm on the air.
Yeah, it's fine. Those make for the best episodes, I think. But my son is like, he's got so much energy, and he's so wild, and he wants to like tackle his sister and tackle us and all that stuff. And so I said to him, I was like, when you turn 5, you'll be able to start wrestling, and you know, amateur wrestling, they have it in the township and everything. And I showed him a video of what amateur wrestling was, and he lost his mind. Like, just, dude. Yeah, I may have told this before, but he's just like,
yeah,
the idea of being able, of being told, like, go tackle this kid, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Like, so I think he's going to be really good at that. We'll have to teach him, collar and elbow tie up is reversed in amateur wrestling than it is in pro wrestling. So we'll have to kind of, break him of all the habits, because I know he's a pretty trained pro wrestler at this point. But,
Just I hope he remembers me when he wins the Olympic gold medal and stuff like that, you know.
Hey, RJ says listeners have to get in line behind Meltzer and Colt Cabana to hate Josh. Well, let's clear this up. Meltzer probably doesn't even know who the hell I am at this point. You know, I'm the guy who kept asking about Mind of the Meanie and Meanie Toons, and then he blocked me, and then I just yell into a void about him. And Colt Cabana, I don't know if I want to kill the gimmick or anything. Colt and I are totally cool. We're all good. I talked to him the other day. There are no issues between me and Colt Cabana. Although that son of a bitch keeps taking my name in vain every time he plays himself on Twitch. But it made for a fun episode of So Says Shernoff, which I hope all of you checked out on Fight.
Yeah, man.
But
congratulations on the get too with Bischoff there.
Thank you. Yeah, no, Bischoff was I thought it was a really good interview. I mean, I could talk to him for hours. And we're two very long-winded people, so you know. But no, he was so great, and just, you know, I appreciated the fact that he didn't phone it in. Not that I had any reason to think he would, but you know, I mean, this is a guy you can only. I can only imagine how many times he's been asked the same question. And I tried my best to ask different questions. Well, yeah, I mean, I don't have to tell you, you've done a couple of interviews. So that was my thought process going into the interview. Was I don't want to ask him just the same thing again that everybody asks him. And I'm sure I succeeded with maybe half of that. I'm sure some of them are the same things, yeah. But he really delivered with a great, and entertaining interview. And I really appreciate him. And the support that he's shown me and my show, has been awesome. He doesn't have to, there's absolutely no reason for him to show me the kind of support that he does. And so I appreciate it very much. Derek Price, now that Retromania is on PlayStation, it's time for Josh versus Meanie with a question mark. I'm not a playable character, but
I got some cool news I wish I could share, but I've been sworn to secrecy. But
will you tell me off air?
Yeah, I'll tell you off air.
All right, so we got what are these three? All right, we got the Jack story.
Yeah.
The thing about the thing, and then the we'll call it the Retromania story.
Yeah.
All right. And the level above Sorensen level is what gets you access to Meanie telling all this stuff.
Are you warm? It's warm in here.
We're not in the same place. So
I'm breaking the seal here. I got the window open a little bit. Get some
of all the seals you could have broken in there. That's probably the best one. I am actually kind of warm. Some people might notice I'm not wearing a hoodie, which I'm almost always wearing a hoodie. But I'm not. I'm kind of warm in here. I'm being kept.
Since we're recording at night, I might have some good quality farts to record.
So. Oh, I hope so. I am being kept warm by the companionship of the Mind of the Meanie action figures that are all over my office here. They're because I've taken them out. We had some damage packaging, which you can purchase at a discounted rate over at mindofthemeanie.com. But there were some damaged ones. There were some that were good. And then there were some that were pristine. And I wanted to make sure that those pristine ones were the ones that got pulled aside to be signed. Because I don't know who's planning to keep them mint on card if they're not signed. But if they order a signed one, you pretty much know they're planning to keep it mint on card. So I wanted to pull aside the absolute best of the best for that. So I really, we had all these boxes, and I've just kind of been, creating these piles. And but I've got them right here. Meanie finally got to have his in hand.
Yes.
And they're just, dude, these are so good. These are so good. I know I'm showing this off on Patreon to people who I think all already have like three of them each, but
what's cool is I finally got to hold the proto
Gesundheit.
So I'm just glad I didn't follow through on that one.
Yeah, you got to hold the prototype.
I got to hold the prototype, and the actual figure, it's got some, like you said, they definitely got some weight to it. It's like, oh my God, that's really cool.
It really is. Like, that was the big difference, and I kind of knew that was coming just from, because I have the Nick Aldis figure, and when I opened the Aldis figure to put out on my shelf on display, I opened that up and instantly noticed a big difference in weight between that and the prototypes that we had. So I was like, this is exciting. That's what's really, I looked at those prototypes and was like, man, I don't ever want to send these back. These are the coolest things in the world, but these figures are cooler in my opinion. They're even, the mass produced aspect of it makes it even cooler.
Look, I've had people who are kind enough to make me customs.
Mm-hmm.
Our figures are based off of Hasbro, and I have a couple. I just remember I have a couple Hasbro customs.
Ooh.
But they're somewhere in this house. My house is such a mess. If somebody's broke into my front door, they go, "Oh, somebody already beat us to it and left," would leave. Just the fact that a company invested money to make action figures and mass produce them really means a lot.
Yeah.
And I brought them home, and they're on the shelf behind me. Mrs. Meanie got out. We have this thing called earthquake putty, mm-hmm. which they use for art museums. So, like, if there's an earthquake and the display, you know, there's an earthquake, nothing tips over or breaks or stuff like that. So,
trying.
Dude, I could just.
Oh, okay. I was trying to move the. There it is. Okay.
Yeah. For the folks watching at home.
For the Patreon members.
Yeah, I'm bad on their directions. So.
There they are.
Yeah. She's got a little earthquake putty on the feet so they don't, my big clumsy ass bumps into it. I won't knock it over, so.
Yeah. No, that's smart, though.
Yeah.
And I tweeted out, and I think I texted you, too, that it's like an honor to be on that shelf, but I was looking at that shelf, and I'm like, all right, so you have a bunch of your figures, you have an Al Snow, and you have a Mick Foley, and you have a me. I was like, that is one of these things. It's not like the others, but so cool. And again, these figures this is really neat because it's representative of the coolest time of my career, you know, and it's just so cool to have. I could stare at them for hours, but it's really cool. And Meanie was up. So up here and signed a bunch of them. I will say also, we just sold out of our concept art, our signed concept art.
Nice.
But 2 days after Meanie was at my house to sign stuff, the new batch came in. So I'm going to send them over to you, Meanie. There's no reason to take another trip. Send them over and you'll sign them and send them back and I'll sign them and then we can get back.
How many did we do this batch? For the second batch?
I think we did 50, maybe 100. I'm not sure. Because we kind of blew through the other ones. So I don't remember if I decided to do 50 or 100.
Hold on. This might be a nighttime fart. Hold on. Might have more.
No.
Almost fucking touched some cloth on that
one. Oh, man. Yep, that was
poking daylight over here.
Mm. Got a little turtle head?
Yeah.
Get back in your shell.
But what were we saying? Oh yeah, the concept art. Yeah, that'd be.
So we got more. We have more coming, or more here, and then you'll sign them. So if you know, feel free to order them now over at mindofthemeanie.com. Mindofthemeanie.bigcartel.com is the direct link, and you'll be able to get the concept art there, the signed concept art. But honestly, we'll have them out in like a week anyway. Derek wants to know status on the wrestling buddies. So why don't we talk a little bit about that, Meanie?
Let's. They are very handsome.
Yes.
They look great.
Yeah. So that's kind of cats out of the bag on that. And there'll be more information as time goes on with it. But the gatter, the brothers Gatter, who have done an amazing job with some of these. I mean, you can go on brothersgatter.com or on Instagram. They're brothers_Gatter. It's GADDOR. They've got officially licensed stuff with, so many. Delirious has one. I'm looking here. Josh Alexander.
There's a Tommy Dreamer and a Raven, I believe.
Tommy Dreamer, Raven. Looks like there's a Mean Gene nice. That just came out, which is awesome. But then they announced, as they put it, blue is on our mind and we're not joshing you. That's kind of funny. We've seen the full things. They look awesome. I'm excited to see them. And that is, so it's kind of neat. It's not really a Mind of the Meanie product as much as it is like they're two in the, it's a Meanie product and a Josh product that you can purchase when they become available. You will be able to purchase them as like a two pack. Cause it's kind of, you know, but it'll be depicting, I believe Meanie, you can tell from just the image, Meanie will be in his BWO shirt. Yes. And I will be, I think they have me in my sarcasm as my superpower tie.
Awesome.
Yeah. And then, yeah, so we'll be able to do that. And then they're putting together, something that will go more into detail as time goes on, but keep August 7th, open. If you're in the New York area, and by New York, I mean really up north in New York. If you're in Canada, really excited about those. Again, it's just like, it's ridiculous at this point. It's like video game action figures, wrestling buddies. Like, this is just the coolest.
So fortunate. So cool, yeah. Man. Yeah. I'm excited to, hopefully I'll be downloading Retromania tonight and playing that, but no, we got the action figures. It's one thing to think about something, talk about something, but to have the actual product in hand is amazing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so cool. And, thanks to the great folks over there for making them for us, because it's something I've never had, you know?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's really cool. To, like you always say, like in 2021, to have people wanting to, you know, but I look at it and go, in any year for people to want to do that of me. And I keep feeling like so bad for these people. I'm like, you're making these things with this expectation that anybody wants this of me. And, but thankfully I'm very lucky that, all of you keep buying stuff. So, you know, apparently they're right. Derek says in the shadows of New York City. Yeah, no, we're not going to be in Jersey. Shadow of New York City.
New Jersey. Oh, so I put on the draft, and there's a Tony Khan in the war room right there.
Yeah?
Yeah. I guess they're the first pick of the second round.
Nice.
I put on the TV to put on the draft, and there's somebody with a huge cutout of Shad Khan's head with the mustache and everything. I was like, oh.
That man's mustache is...
Yeah.
It's a thing
of beauty. High quality.
Yeah. It's a thing of beauty.
But, we're talking, you know, we're on a wrestling podcast, and the owner of AEW is on the NFL draft right now, which is pretty cool. In the war room.
I was listening to Conrad Thompson answer a couple of questions. You know Conrad.
Nice.
Great Love guy. Him. And I was listening to him, and he was talking about something that was kind of interesting. About WWE, and it just made me think, because he mentioned the fact that the Khan family have like four times the amount of money as the McMahon family, which I'd be happy to have 1/4 the money the McMahon family has. So, you know,
I'll have their pocket change.
Yeah. I was going to say, we're not throwing stones here, but, Conrad has this theory, this belief that the WWE is going to be sold in the next 5 years. And he has said he has no inside information, no like whatever. This is just, he believes that an NBC, a Disney, someone like that is going to buy WWE. As someone who worked for that company, what do you think? When I heard him say that, I was like, I want to ask Meanie about this. And just since everyone's so pissed off, I figured I'd ask you about it on the air. So we have enough stuff to talk about off the air. What do you think? Do you see that ever happening?
Man, I would hope that he would just let Hunter and stuff just take over, or, you know, something like that, man. Just, it's been in the McMahon family name for decades, you know, and there's tradition and lineage attached to the name. Just to sell it like that, you know, I mean... It's not like he needs the money to, you know, right. It's not like he's the Crockett's in a pinch because they accidentally went and bought, you know, the UWF when they didn't really have to, just to get the TV deal and stuff like that. And, you know, had to sell to Turner, you know.
Well, there's always been that story that Vince McMahon, what did they do? They bought, trying to think how the way the story goes. They bought something. They gave McMahon money, and he used it to against them or something. I really shit the bed on that.
Yeah,
it was something I can't remember the story. Help me out here, people, Patreon members. There's something about, Vince McMahon, maybe with WrestleMania, like they bought the TV time slot from the McMahons. Right? Who was it? Was it Jim Crockett?
Oh, are you talking about back in the day?
Yeah.
Here's the deal. Okay, now that I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're trying to have a fart on the air, and I'm just having brain farts left and right. So we're
Georgia Championship Wrestling. There was Georgia Championship Wrestling.
Right.
And then the Briscoes, Jerry and Jack, sold their portions of Georgia Championship Wrestling to Vince, which was it Black Saturday?
Right. Well, that was right.
So here's the deal. So Vince is doing, wrestling on TBS, and TBS isn't happy they're not happy with the product. They want more in-studio wrestling, mm-hmm. studio wrestling, stuff like that. So it didn't last too long. So, there's friction between Ted and Vince over the wrestling product on TBS. So in turn, Vince sells the time slot that Georgia Championship Wrestling had to the Crocketts, which they in turn came in and created the TV show World Championship Wrestling on Saturday nights, which became, was the famous 6:05 Saturday night.
Right. And McMahon used that money for WrestleMania, didn't he?
Yeah, he turned around and he flipped it and put it towards the first WrestleMania.
And then there was the other story, too, that Jerry McDivitt told at a live Something to Wrestle, and this is where I've heard that story from Conrad talking about it, where there was a lawsuit between WWF and WCW, and WWF won. It may have been the Razor Diesel thing, and okay. WWF won, and a couple of years later took that money and bought WCW with it.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So but that's where I'm going with that is it kind of makes me wonder about, here's an example, WCW, right? WWE owns the rights to WCW. You can't have another, you cannot, WCW can never return because WWE owns the rights to it. ECW.
I saw
something on Twitter. It's coming back in the next couple months. but WCW can't come back. ECW can't come back because WWE owns it.
Right.
However, theoretically speaking,
right,
an opportunity presents itself. Vince McMahon, there are things he would just never do because it's just, I'm not selling that. I'm not getting rid of it. We're holding it to hold it. Mm-hmm. But now, let's say NBC owns WWE, so they own the trademarks of WCW. They own the library of WCW, all that stuff. And the Khan family comes in and says, it'd be a fun thing if we just relaunched WCW as like an extra thing. And why would they? But I'm just saying, theoretically,
they've basically tried so far.
Right.
And that's not a knock. They're trying to get Dusty's, Dusty's.
They're bringing back that brand of entertainment, that brand of sports entertainment, that brand of wrestling. Yeah. And yeah. But let's say they come back, and let's say Tony Khan, more realistically, Tony Khan looks at it and says, we need our own Starcade. And then goes, I want us to have Starcade. Vince McMahon's not giving you Starcade. He likes to have it as that little house show thing, which is ridiculous that they do that. But now McMahon no longer owns Starcade, right? Because WWE was sold, and all of their intellectual property and all the, trademarks. Technically, I think there's a much greater opportunity that AEW comes in and grabs something like a Starcade, like a Halloween Havoc, like any of these things where NBC or Disney or whatever go like, I'd rather us just add to our bottom line. I don't really give a shit about holding on to Starcade, And it makes me interested to see what could happen.
But that said, I could easily see Vince being willing to sell it back to, Dustin, Vince is about making money. If you put enough zeros on that check and he could take that money and then reinvest it in WWE or buy a new boat or something. Mm-hmm. I don't see why he would do that. Look, he wouldn't do that, you know?
Anything can happen, right? Like, never say never in wrestling, and certainly not with Vince McMahon. I mean, he's proven that time and time again. But it's just there, the thing, you talk about the forbidden door, right? Like, there's these things.
Which I've only heard that phrase until this year for some
I know,
reason.
I'd never heard of it either, and apparently it's like this big, you know, but I don't know. I'm sure Meltzer had heard of it.
Yeah.
But there are these things that are just like you look and you go, it's never going to happen. Like, for instance, somebody comes with a lot of money and says, I want to relaunch ECW. I want the logo. I want the music. I want this. I want that. And WWE's going to be like, yeah, no, we own that and we're not giving that to you. But
hey, yeah.
Disney could look at that and say, we're Disney. We are never putting on an ECW. Take it. Who gives it? We don't want this. This doesn't go with the Disney, you know, whatever. Like, and then here comes somebody, doesn't have to be a Tony Khan, although he was a diehard ECW fan, but somebody with a lot of money comes in and says, I think it's time to relaunch ECW. Hey, Paul Heyman, you don't work for WWE anymore. You want to come have some fun? Yeah. Like, you know, to me, that is the only part of it that kind of got me a little excited. The idea of, like, who knows, maybe something... Like, maybe 10, 15, 20 years from now, something crazy can happen in wrestling that you and I didn't think could ever happen because of a sale like that.
Well, I want to say there was, like, a slight precedence of Vince being, you know, cool. And that was him letting the trademark for Cody Rhodes just go. And Cody, you know, could reclaim his name. Mm-hmm. I would guarantee if Cody had a one-on-one conversation, you know, called Vince and said, hey, look, it's my father's inventions. Please, can I just help carry on the name of my father? You're not using it. You don't need it. What do you say? I think Vince, like, for all the shit people, you know, Vince isn't a saint, right? There's things Vince has done that, you know, could be criticized, rightfully so, and sometimes overly criticized. But, you know, I think he does respect tradition and stuff like that. And I think he would, you know, turn around and say, hey, yeah, okay, you want your father's creations? Fine. But with the caveat that we don't have to pay your royalty to show the old footage. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, here's the name, but we keep the rights on the footage. We don't have to pay a royalty for the thing we already own that we're selling to you. So,
And you know what? Honestly, I think you're right. I think you get a bunch of lawyers involved, and so it's like dead on the table. I think you have like a Tony Khan or a Cody sitting down with Vince or a Triple H or something, and I feel like business gets done. You know. But they might not want it. But then there's the question also, you know, Bash at the Beach. AEW brought back Bash at the Beach. And next thing you know, a year later, it's like Beach Bash or whatever. Not Beach Bash, they're calling it something, but not Bash at the Beach. Coincidentally, right around the same time, Cody becomes Cody Rhodes. So you start to say, like, was there a trade in the other direction?
Yeah.
Did they say, you can have Bash at the Beach back, give me the Rhodes name? You know,
yeah.
So it's weird. Yeah. It's you know, and this is kind of
Vince is a businessman,
but this is what I loved about part of my conversation that I had. Cheap plug, you know, with Eric Bischoff on So Says Shernoff on Fight. Part of what I loved about that conversation was we talked about how so many people just don't get what is going on behind the scenes. You know, you'll think a storyline went this way or that way, and you don't understand the involvement of talent or the involvement of this or that or all these different moving pieces. And I feel like that's the same thing. You know, we can sit here and go, well, why don't they just have Starcade? It's like, well, you know, who knows what that, you know. But I did see Billy Gunn is Billy Gunn again.
Yeah.
And then from Billy Gunn to being Billy for a little while, for about a year. And somewhere along the way, he's Billy Gunn again. So... did they let it lapse? Did Mike Dawkins swoop in there and grab it? You know, at 12:01, you know, it's Yeah. Who knows? Shout out to Mike Dawkins. Good dude.
Great guy, man.
Yeah.
Great guy. He's doing a lot of good things, man. I see, you know.
Really is.
We see you.
James Sorensen says, you didn't talk about my lunch interaction with him. And then he wrote, ha, 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 because he's obviously joking. But James, who says that wasn't left on the cutting room floor? Who says that Eric Bischoff and I didn't spend an hour and a half before we started recording talking about the lunch that you had with him and how you abandoned the mind of the meanie to go hang out? And you left your home in the bosom of the mind of the meanie to take a drive over to Cody, Wyoming and hang out with Eric Bischoff. I would have done the same thing, but... No.
And the Jaguars take a cornerback.
Oh, man. Okay.
Breaking news. Speaking of Tony Khan, he was just on my screen. Sorry.
I was going to say, we're here talking about Tony Khan, and he is busy not giving a shit about Starcade. he's busy building his football franchise.
We'll call it Starcade with three R's.
Oh, man. Hey, you want to ask Meanie anything?
I would love to.
Let's do it.
It's time to ask Meanie anything. Ask me something!
Alrighty. We got some questions here.
I crack myself up every time because you do, would you like to ask Meanie anything? I go, I would love to, which really makes no fucking sense.
You would like to ask Meanie anything, yeah.
Yeah, I am Meanie.
You know what, Meanie?
But
take a long, hard look in the mirror and ask yourself something right now. Yeah. Go for it.
Before we do, let me open up my seltzer.
Dude, I don't even have seltzer today.
You piece of shit.
Yep, I don't even have it. I've got a Deer Park water and an ice cold coffee from earlier today. A little lemon lime ugly.
Dude, yeah, that seems to... It's perfect for the fucking summer.
Yeah.
So, yeah. There we go. Hey, Tony.
This one's for you, Tony. Hey,
thank
you
for
what?
Not taking the guy I wanted.
Hey, before we get into Ask Meanie, why don't we talk about our great sponsor today? And that's manscaped.com. That's right, Manscaped. Flowers are blooming, the grass is growing, and it's time to chop the weeds, Meanie. Thanks to the support of Manscaped, you can trim your holes safely and efficiently. I'm talking about ball trimmers. Manscaped, the global leaders in men's below-the-waist grooming, have an exclusive offer for our audience. Use code MEANIE20 to get 20% off plus free shipping at manscaped.com. Join the other 2 million men who trust Manscaped. They are here to make sure you are trimmed and smelling nice. After all, it's time for some spring cleaning. Meanie, are you cleaning your balls?
Just polish them like a set of bowling balls.
Do it. Manscaped, they're the global leaders in men's below-the-waist grooming and have forever changed the grooming game. They're amazing products. They are here to help with your above-the-waist holes, too. That's right. It's not just below-the-waist holes. It's above-the-waist holes. We're talking about the Weed Whacker, the nose and ear hair trimmer. It provides proprietary skin-safe technology, which helps prevent nicks, snags, and tugs in those delicate holes. No more gross nose hairs flying in the wind. The premium Manscaped Weed Whacker uses a 9,000 RPM motor-powered 360-degree rotary dual-blade system. Manscaped is making whacking your weeds a time to look forward to, delivering maximum confidence while providing hygiene. Meanie, have you been enjoying whacking your weeds?
Dude, seriously, mine came in the mail about a week ago, and... No, I'm getting to that age where I have to be mindful of, no pun intended, ear and nose hair, man. I'm getting to that, and sometimes if I don't pay attention, I start wandering into Ernest Borgnine territory. I start looking like, if I sneeze, my nose looks like party favor. It's just, But for straight shoot, man, the weed whacker is amazing. It cuts the hairs. You don't get tear up. It doesn't snag. And it's quiet. Manscaped technology is amazing. Even something as simple as holding in my hand the contour of the trimmer is very nice. And it comes with a nice little USB charger. You can plug it in. It charges up super quick. And then, you know, when you go to cut my nose and ear hair, I've had those ones in the past where it just, it's like I'm being tortured for questions, give me the answer. This, it's just very nice, very quiet, and very clean. It's a very clean product. I love it.
Hey, we're talking about incredible hygiene here. Manscaped has formulations to keep you fresh and ready for everything that comes your way all day. Of course, we're talking about the Crop Preserver. It's an anti-chafing ball deodorant moisturizer. It's starting to get hot outside, and this is crucial so your balls stop sticking to your leg. That's the legit worst. You'll also find the Crop Reviver spray-on toner for your balls, which will keep you smelling fresh down there, just like spring flowers. Speaking of smelling fresh, complete your grooming game this spring with the new Refined Cologne signature scent by Manscaped. This stuff is legit and will have you smelling like royalty. The cologne is light, approachable, and gentlemanly in all the right ways. You'll be the talk of the next quarantine hang. Smell good, feel good this spring. Get 20% off plus free shipping with the code MEANIE20 at manscaped.com. Do yourself a favor and always use the right tools for the job. Again, that's 20% off and free shipping with the code MEANIE20 at manscaped.com. This spring cleaning, baby. It's spring cleaning, baby. That's what I meant to say. Not this spring cleaning, baby. There is a baby going around with a dustpan and... And that baby and your balls will thank you. Manscaped.com, promo code.
Kids got to earn tuition somehow.
Seriously. all right, we're going to ask Meanie anything. Let's get back into the swing of it again.
It's time to ask Meanie anything. Ask me something.
All right, we're back.
I would love to.
Travis Bohab. Did you have any interactions with Roddy Piper after you got into the wrestling business?
I wouldn't even call it like an interaction. I met him as a fan, as I showed with the photos earlier. We did this convention / wrestling event in San Francisco that we called the San Fran Fiasco. And... Piper was there, and it was just a quick two ships passing, and I, hello, Mr. Piper. Because Piper's like the real deal, I approach Piper the way I approached the original Sheik, So there's always that element of danger,
sure,
Reality Roddy Piper, which comes across great in the Piper documentary or biography on A&E. But yeah, man, very brief. Nothing to say with substance or some whatever.
I can't substance.
Say, I can't. Yes, I can't say words today.
You said words perfectly right there. The word words. That was it. Hashtag dad jokes. All right.
Yes.
So I'm 3/4 of the way through the Roddy Piper documentary, so I haven't finished yet, but I love it so far. It's fantastic. And that kind of leads into the RJ Krasinski of it all. His question, who should there be a documentary on that hasn't had one recently or at all? Obviously, we're going to exclude the ones that we know. We've got like 6 more that are coming up on A&E, but is there a documentary about somebody? Hasn't been covered on the network, hasn't been covered by Dark Side, hasn't been covered by A&E, is there someone where you just, there's a documentary that you're looking for regarding wrestling?
Ladies and gentlemen, the life story of Frankie Williams from Columbo, Ohio. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. The guy, speaking of Piper, the guy Piper beat up on Piper's Pit.
Oh, yeah. I might not be a good wrestler.
But I'm out there no matter what. I'm
trying my best.
I'm out there no matter what. Oh, you're out there no matter what. But seriously, who haven't they done a documentary or a biography on?
They may have done this, but I've got an idea. Vince McMahon.
Well, that's in the works.
They're doing a movie, right?
Well, it's going to be a documentary.
Is it going to be a documentary, Netflix. Not a movie?
What's his name? Oh, my God. The guy used to work at ESPN. He's got his own podcast network now. Oh, my God. I can't think of his name. He's from Boston. But it's going to be like a docuseries on Vince McMahon.
Okay. Well, that's amazing. But I'd want it to be...
through Netflix.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But hopefully they do a deep dive, man. I really want them to go deep into his grandfather, who was a boxing promoter.
Well, that's the thing. I don't want it to just be a superficial fluff piece. I want to hear things we've never heard before. I want to, you know, no pun intended, you know, pull no punches. And like you said, go back to Jess McMahon. Learn about that. Learn about Vince McMahon. I'd love to learn about Vince and his upbringing. You know, we've heard little stories here and there, little things about his relationship to with his family. And, but man, upbringing makes a person who they are. And yeah. Vince McMahon is such a fascinating dude that I just, you know, I'd love a documentary on it, like a deep, deep dive documentary on him. So yeah. So good.
I'm thinking Vince is getting to the age where he wants to tell his story, mm-hmm. you know, and do it not his way, but in the way he thinks is correct. Because, you know, I'm sure he still claims, you know, beyond the mat, you know, was a double cross, and I thought it was going to be in art houses, and you know, what the hell, pal? Yeah. So I don't know if he's, I don't know if he holds animosity towards documentaries, but, you know, oh my God, I wish I could remember. I'm rambling because I'm trying to think of the guy's name who's supposed to be producing it. And, yeah, it's going to be really good. The guy who they got on board. I want to say it was the same guy who did the Andre the Giant documentary for HBO.
Oh, wow, okay.
So
yeah, that should be really good.
The guy's a diehard sports fan, diehard wrestling fan. He's always on. He was on when they were doing their own version of like these top 10 lists on the WWE network. They had him on there. It's driving me nuts.
So Travis is saying he wants a real one, not one made by WWE. And now WWE, they put together incredible documentaries, but there's a narrative, of course. And I find it really hard to imagine a Vince McMahon documentary that he is a part of that does not support his narrative.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that, you know, to knock him. Meanie, I'm sure you could, if somebody came to you and said, hey, Meanie, we want to do a documentary about you, and hey, we'd like you to be involved in the process. You know, there might be some things where you just go, that's not the way I see it. Don't go telling that. Don't go telling the story that way. Here's how it really happened, you know? And, you know, so I think it's going to be really tough to have a documentary that Vince McMahon is involved in that, unless it's another double cross. And those days are...
Let me look up this guy's name. It's going to drive me nuts.
Yeah, do it. Now, those days are long behind us of Vince McMahon getting double crossed on something like that, because lawyers will tear that apart. There's no way that documentary sees the light of day without his approval, you know? So,
yeah.
While you're doing that, Mark and Dryden writes, what do you two think about Dave Meltzer's comments, Charlotte's response?
Bill Simmons.
Yes. Okay. Bill Simmons. Now I know exactly who you're talking about. Now I feel like an idiot.
Yeah, he does good stuff.
Mark wants to know, what do you two think about Dave Meltzer's comments, Charlotte's response, and should something be done about Dave? For my my opinion, go to So Says Shernoff on Fight or at youtube.com/So Says Shernoff. I covered it briefly. I'll be honest with you. I'm starting to get sick of talking about Dave Meltzer on my show.
Yeah.
And not as sick as this one fan who kind of went off on me today. Apparently, he was unhappy with last month's show, and then he commented about how it's okay because I say so, and I made light of the fact that, yeah, because the show's called So Says Shernoff, it's my opinion, and he did not like that and felt that I was being incredibly hypocritical to insult Dave Meltzer about, and you know what? Maybe I am, whatever. As I told the guy.
Or maybe not.
Plans change. And, you know, the way I see it is if that guy thinks I'm doing such a bad job, then I suggest he do a better one on his show on Fight. But I digress. As far as Meltzer, I think what it really comes down to, when I'm not trying to editorialize it or, you know, try and make it a fun show, I think at the end of the day, the dude's just a bit of a jack off, you know. He's just a toolbox and that's it. And he says things because he thinks they're going to be funny, or he thinks it makes him seem like he's in the know, and he upset Charlotte. You know, he said that she was getting dental work done because the wrestling business has made her self-conscious. I don't know. I haven't spoken to Charlotte about it, and according to Charlotte, neither did he. So as far as I'm concerned, I know just as much about the dental work she had done as Dave Meltzer does. And unfortunately, as she put it, you know, he could have called her and asked. And
as she explained in the rebuttal tweet.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, to me, I look at it and Dave Meltzer has a proven track record of making stuff up. And Charlotte has no reason to say that's not true. And at the same time, it's like, there are some things that just aren't necessary. Like, why, you know, for him to go, oh yeah, Charlotte's on a, you know, they suspended her so she could get dental work done because she's self-conscious. First of all, maybe I'd have to go back and look at pictures of Charlotte's teeth. There's nothing about her teeth that have made me feel like she needs work done. But guess what? I'm also not her. And here's the thing. If she is self-conscious about it, whether it's through wrestling or something that always bothered her or whatever, how the hell is that any of our business? Go get your teeth done. Go do whatever it is that makes you happy. That's not, and I don't know that's my feeling on it, Mark. And Meanie, he wants your opinion.
Dude, it's just, like you said, it's just, you know, Dave's an opinionist. He's not a reporter, really. He's an opinionist, and, you know, there are people who give them what they want him to report.
Right.
Maybe not exactly what might be the truth, but what, you know, people want out there. Who, if she's getting down to work, you know.
Gives a shit.
Or as he said, she's feeling subconscious.
Is that what he said? Subconscious?
He said she feels subconscious, which.
Did he really? And I covered that on my show and missed the fact that he said subconscious instead of self-conscious.
Yes.
Oh, damn it. Now I got to freaking talk about him again next month.
But yeah. So, Dave's an opinionist. He's basically almost like a parody of himself now. So it's just like, what could be done? Nothing. The only thing you can be done is you want somebody to calm down, him in the pocketbook, stop subscribing to his newsletter, stop listening to his radio show.
I just think there's no reason to listen.
Stop giving him oxygen.
Yeah. There's no reason to listen to him if you believe that what he's saying is bullshit. You know, there are so many wrestling, journalists, actual journalists. There are people who are, you know, wrestling reporters. There's so many people out there who are working so hard to try and create something positive. And I am not including myself. I do a fun satirical comedy show that half the time isn't funny. But, you know, it's, but there are people out there. Go support them. You know, show them the support. Don't pay Meltzer because the guy's a mark for himself first.
I got some breaking news. Eagles are on the clock, so.
Oh, geez.
Let's see. I'm going to give this a little bit of volume. Same guy, same Eagles fan who's painted silver is there again today with a face shield.
It's Rey Mysterio from SummerSlam.
Yeah. Who they got coming out? The pick is in. I wanted to be the super fan they put on that fart couch. That would like a little couch where they bring up a fan of the team.
Yep.
I should be able to raise the volume a little.
Do it.
I see enough people playing there.
Yeah, let's hear it. Let's hear what's going on. What's the clock at right now?
The pick is in.
Oh.
It was like immediate. Here we go. Shh, shh, shh. Here we go. Pick.
Select a guard from Alabama, Landon Dickerson.
Landon Roll Dickerson. Tide.
Roll Tide.
Yeah.
Oop.
We got a second guy from Alabama 2 days in a row.
Man. Dude.
Conrad's going to have to come.
Conrad's just going to be fabbing your text left and right, man.
Basically it looks like they might have found Jason Kelsey's replacement. It's not who I wanted, the dude from Notre Dame, but hey, big boy. Yeah. Well, you know what, this is good. Offensive lineman, young. Mm-hmm. So you get some youth on the offensive line. So
I think it's also really cool. This is such a big part of your life, and that we actually got to watch that or listen to that live on the air.
Oh, you should have seen me last night. I wish we were recorded last night. I legit stood up and, you know, fist pumped.
I do feel bad for the fans that are listening who are not football fans from Philadelphia.
Or from America. They listen to the proper football.
Hey, here's another question for you. One comes to us from a friend of the show and Eric Bischoff's best friend, James Sorensen. James writes,
level.
Coming straight from the Sorensen level, what championship do you hope they find on the WWE Treasure Show?
Oh.
Are they looking for a championship?
They could. We don't know what the next episodes are, you know?
Yeah, the next episode, what is it, Bruce Pritchard just showing up at Conrad's house?
Yeah, basically.
And if Conrad Thompson does not appear on that show at some point, I'm going to be shocked.
He's got it. Dude, I was amazed that they had the old Tito's antenna in their continental belt, the one before the Randy Savage, you know, the one we all fell in love with. Because Tito had told me that he threw that belt in the fucking trash in the Baltimore arena. He's like, mm-hmm. Well, Greg destroyed the belt, and I knew they were getting a new belt. I didn't need it anymore.
And they
have it? So I threw it in the trash. Dude, they showed it. Like, I made a still of it. I'll post it on social media tonight. It's
so they haven't, like, said that they have it. It's just.
Yeah, I saw it.
Oh, man.
And I legit sat up and went, oh, my God, they got it. Maybe somebody just picked it out of the trash at the arena, you know? Yeah. Maybe one of the producers went, oh, what are you throwing the trash for?
Yeah.
You know, because to me that would have been a great documentary, kind of like when they went and looked for the old Atari games in the dump. You know,
are they going to be going under Carano's bed? is that where it's taking us? Yeah. I hear under his bed looks like Conrad's office. So,
yeah.
Allegedly, according to his ex-wife, right? Isn't that who said it?
It's weird. He's from Mrs. Meanie's hometown.
Yeah.
Like, we go to a bar in West Haven, Connecticut, and called Johnny's, which I call McCusker's North. And the bartender's like, yeah, this guy comes in from the WWE. His name's Mark. I was like, oh, all right. Yeah. So, Yeah.
Tell him to give me a call.
Yeah.
But not anymore. There's a weird amount of people that got that they cleaned house with. Joe Villa. That was surprising to me. He handled a lot. I don't know exactly what his like day to day was, but he was my contact when I was doing like press stuff with them a couple years ago for WrestleMania.
Okay.
He was the He gave me the passes and all the stuff like that, and he was my contact for that. So he was also, I remember I was living in California and they were coming for Raw, and I was like, mate, wonder if they need like extras. I haven't wrestled in 10 years. Why not? You know? And I asked, Charles Robinson who I should like, do you know who I'm supposed to talk to? And he's like, yeah, send Joe Villa a thing. It didn't go anywhere. But yeah, so Mark and Dryden has an, is there a belt? Is there a championship? Is there one that you're like, you haven't seen anybody has that you wish you'd like
well,
to see?
Well, I mean, my favorite belt is the UWF TV title, but Nikita has that.
Okay.
And I was fortunate enough to take a photo with it, but, I don't know what they could possibly have. I'll have to get back on that one because it's a matter of, I don't know. Well, then again, the whole thing of the show is they have to go out and find it, yeah. Right? So, you know,
they're going out to find it. Like, clearly they know who has it. You know what I mean? Like, it's not so much going out to find it, I guess, as much as it's like, well, except for the Undertaker's one. He apparently didn't know what he had, and he had a lot of stuff there. That was the closest we'll ever see to the return of the old school Undertaker was him trying on his purple.
That's so cool.
Although, you know, my brother, not to talk about, you know, people that nobody knows nor cares about, but my brother from adfreeshows.com, if I'm allowed to talk about him now, he pointed out that with that, like, it bothered him a little bit that they were giving such history to this the double cross urn, you know, the urn that Paul Bearer had to turn on the Undertaker, and they're like, this urn launched the career of Kane and launched the career of, you know, and it was like, you're looking back, you're like, kind of in a lot of ways kind of killed a lot of the like at that point when they took Paul Bearer away from the Undertaker. In a lot of ways, that was the beginning of the end of what a lot of fans that were kids at that time consider like the real Undertaker, you know? So it wasn't held in such high regard. And I also don't really understand how that, I mean, that's a stretch that urn led to Kane, you know, it was like, what was that, summer of 96?
Yeah. My timeline sucks. So
summer of 96, Paul Bearer hits Undertaker with the urn.
Oh, I remember the angle. I just don't remember what year.
2+ years later, they start the Kane. He was running around as fake Diesel, I think, at that point in time. Like,
well, I think the point they were trying to get is, if Paul Bearer hadn't turned on Undertaker,
right, never would have happened.
There would be no reason for Paul Bearer to bring somebody back from Undertaker's past.
He's alive! Kane, he's alive! Oh, yeah!
My Undertaker!
Mark,
blue boy, please.
Last question here. Another one from Mark and Dryden. Was watching WCCW on the network and was curious. Let's fantasy book. If Gino Hernandez and Chris Adams appeared in ECW, who would have been some great singles and tag team opponents for them?
Wow. Wow. Oh, man. Shit, they could have easily been part of Triple Threat. You know, Gino and Chris, you know, fantasy booking, you know, still alive. Yeah, they could have been part of, you know, triple threat, because originally it was Malenko and Malenko, Benoit, and Shane. And then, you know, once those two left, he, you know, bring in Gino and Chris Adams. And I think the crowd would have exploded. You know, granted, if, you know, Gino wasn't swiped up by WWE at the time.
Right.
But then again, according to Bruce Pritchard, you know, Gino didn't get like to wrestle anywhere that he couldn't fly his personal jet to. So. You want to book me? Sure. What's your closest airport? You know?
Yeah.
But, man. Yeah, definitely. They would definitely have been in the triple threat. Singles matches. Man, I would love to have. Gino was such the ultimate heel.
I feel like him and a Tommy Dreamer. Tommy him was such like the working man kind of, you know, like Gino Hernandez with that kind of pretty much that like $1 million man style heel.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah. I would have loved to have seen Chris Adams against Rob Van Dam. You know, with the whole, both having martial arts backgrounds and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, the creator of the super kick. You know, as far as pro wrestling, you know.
Sure.
I'm sure somebody did it at one time, but the first time I ever saw the super kick was Chris Adams. I would love to see him against Rob Van Dam or Jerry Lynn, you know. But, yeah, man.
Hey, speaking of Rob Van Dam, is a perfect opportunity just to plug over on adfreeshows.com tomorrow as we record this on a Friday, but a couple days ago it became available, but you can go over to adfreeshows.com and for free check out this month's That Was Extreme with myself, Blue Meanie, and Joel Gertner, where we talk the ECW career of Rob Van Dam. It was a lot of fun.
Absolutely.
Shout out to Josh Odom, who helped with the research on this one, and forced me to have to read a bunch of garbage from Dave Meltzer. But thank you, Josh Odom from Ad Free Shows, who helped me out with that. And, yeah, that was very cool. But I think Gino, I'm trying to think who else. I mean, you would have had your, like, little, like, Sandman or something. I see, like, anyone that wasn't, like, his style, you know. I could see him thinking like they're like beneath him type deal, you know. What else was there? James Sorensen wants to know, do you think that he could have been world champion in ECW?
Who, Gino? Yeah, he could have been world champion anywhere.
I was gonna say, yeah. Now, I mean, I'm not, I only know him from stories of him and watching tape back, you know.
If he had stayed alive, he would have been a horseman too. I would, you know.
Oh man, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But that's, I know we're talking about UCW, but there's so much you could have done.
Yeah. It's crazy to look back on that, you know. What could have been with so many different talent, and you know, timing's everything, and of course, obviously,
absolutely,
people's personal demons and issues and things that, you know, but hey, Dark Side of the Ring, season one, you know, They cover that.
They just announced the lineup for season three.
Oh, man, how good does that look?
Hey, the one I had a hand in helping them pitch the Johnny K-9 / Bruiser Bredlam episode.
Have they interviewed you for anything with that?
I wish they did.
Man.
But, yeah, I told them, you know, people they – you know, I suggest the people they could interview, like, you know.
I mean, I guess they already did it, right?
Yeah.
Because otherwise I was going to say they needed to interview you wearing the big guy shirt available at prowrestlingtees.com/mindofthemeanie.
Yeah.
So if you really want to be able to enjoy Dark Side of the Ring season 3, the Johnny K-9 episode, you need to go to prowrestlingtees.com/mindofthemeanie, pick up a big guy shirt.
Big guy.
It's the one with the it's the one that looks like the Canadian flag with a ruler. yeah, so but that's it for Ask Meanie questions.
Some good questions.
Oh, Vanessa was asking Gino and Scotty Flamingo, later known as Raven, as a tag team.
That would have been great. Yeah.
I was a big fan of Scotty Flamingo back in the WCW. Like, I remember watching him and just being like, ah, oh, yeah, I like this dude. I don't know why. Like,
that was basically really Scotty, you know?
Yeah.
Just a character, you know, because you know, Scotty would just be like a fun slash, you know, character, you know, in real life, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then some of the stuff he would just do as Scotty Flamingo was just an extension of himself, you know, just exaggerated, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey, so that's, well, thank you everybody for your questions there. This is the point in the show where I do a couple of plug skis, or maybe just a couple of thank yous. Thank you to Brian Myers from the Major Wrestling podcast for taking a picture with our figures and posting that all over social media. I'm waiting for Matt Cardona to post his and then send my figure right on over to Duke the Dumpster Drosy, which is what he calls it when he throws things out that he doesn't want to keep. But yeah, if you're interested, there's still a few left. We've got a bunch of signed ones and a handful of unsigned figures. You can go to mindofthemeanie.com or go to mindofthemeanie.bigcartel.com if you're inside the U.S. Now, you can go and you can get the signed concept art anywhere in the world. We'll ship that to you. But unfortunately, we had to contact a couple of people who ordered the figures from outside the U.S., and I don't think you want to pay $57 shipping for a $45 figure, you know? So we have, if you're listening to this and that's you, check your email because you've been contacted, to set up, being refunded your money, and head on over to cellatoys.net. If you're outside the U.S., they will take care of you. They will ship it to you. And you'll get those figures. But we don't want to, I mean, obviously we can't ship it to you for more money than we've sold the figure for. That's not exactly how business works, but if you want it so badly that you're willing to pay more than what the figure itself is worth for us to ship it to you, we'll do it. But I would rather us refund you the money and you go buy it from Cella Toys. And that's just looking out for you. 'Cause trust me, we make less money if you do it that way. But we have no interest in stealing your money. But go over to cellatoys.net. If you're outside the U.S. and inside the U.S., go to mindofthemeanie.com and you'll see the links on there and check that out. Of course, go to prowrestlingtees.com/mindofthemeanie, for all the great Mind of the Meanie shirts that, that Andy Slichter has made. Also available now are Mind of the Meanie stickers and the pins. We still got some pins. Go pick up those pins. There's a couple of them still lying around. What are you guys doing? James Sorensen asked, could Meanie have been world champion in ECW? Yeah, if he had been booked to win.
Yeah.
You know?
It's up to the promoter.
Yeah.
Up to the booker, man. Booker, man.
Could Meanie have handled it? Yes, he could have. He's a freaking pro. Yeah, so also speaking of Meanie and the ECW days and the BWO, head on over to prowrestlingtees.com/BlueMeanie and get some of that great merchandise over there, like the shirt Blue Meanie is wearing right now that you can not see if you're not on Patreon, but it's always extreme in Philadelphia with the Swanson and Rittner streets, street signs there. I love that shirt. I need to get that shirt. Because I love Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and I love ECW, and I love the Blue Meanie, so I'm going to have to get myself that shirt. You can also go over to prowrestlingtees.com/SoSaysShernoff if you want to pick up some of my shirts, like the great So Says Shernoff logo tee that I'm wearing right now. And then please go to fight.tv and check out So Says Shernoff, the newest episode with Eric Bischoff, or go to youtube.com/So Says Shernoff and check that out. But if you're all about the mind of the meanie, you want to go to youtube.com/mind of the meanie. You want to click like, you want to hit that subscribe button, and you want to ding-a-ling that little bell, because that's going to let you know when you get another Mrs. Meanie run-in at some point, when you get new bonus features from Mind of the Meanie. And if you're anybody other than that one person who left a review and you want to check out me talking with my friends from high school that nobody knows nor cares for, you can go check out Talking with Friends at youtube.com/mindoftheMeanie. We're recording another one next week.
Awesome.
Yeah, I hope you all check that out. Hey, Cameo, that's a fun one. Go to cameo.com/BlueMeanieBWO, and the Blue Meanie will send you a nice message, right?
I have one to film as soon as we get off the air here.
Sweet. Was that, are you giving me a hint? Of course, you can also go over there if you want to be the only person in the world who has a cameo from me. Go to cameo.com/So Says Shernoff. Hey, while you're at it, follow us on social media at Mind of the Meanie across all platforms. Follow us as individuals. He is at Blue Meanie BWO. I am at So Says Shernoff. And check out That Was Extreme over at adfreeshows.com. I feel like we need a new show where basically we spend 2 hours just talking about our social medias and all the different things we're doing. But we're having fun, man. We're having a really good time, and we'll be doing some more stuff with Fight TV soon. And
got a lot of good things going on here on our planet, known as Mind of the Meanie. And thank you for everybody for making it. Making it possible. Without you, we are nothing.
Yes. And thank you to our Patreon folks. We hope that you're enjoying the video version of this. And we really do encourage everybody to just come try us out. Try us out for a little bit on Patreon. A
little test run.
Yeah. Just give it a shot. Come on. Do it.
Do it. I dare you. Do it. Yeah. Do it.
You don't have the balls to join our Patreon. I know you listening right now. Nah, you don't have the guts.
Double dog there.
No, but we appreciate that. We appreciate all of the support. And we're able to do fun things. Like when we signed all of those figures, we went live on our Patreon exclusive Facebook page.
So much fun. So
yeah, that was a blast. You get to hear the Blue Meanie yelling to my wife what type of cake he wants. That was fantastic. Apparently, a little inside baseball, the kitchen window was open, which is why she was able to hear you and hear our conversation.
That's awesome.
But apparently the kitchen window was open and my neighbors down the street, because they heard you as well. And hey, Vanessa Bello says join the Patreon. So
much fun.
She says it. Let's do it. James Sorensen says, Mind of the Meanie is a great investment, and I will continue to be part of the amazingness. And he is a Sorensen level member. Sorensen level shirt was created specifically for him and may or may not be sold to everybody. Who knows? Thank you all so much. As always, this is a blast. This is so much fun. Meanie, thank you. And enjoy the rest of the draft, man.
Oh. Yeah, man. We'll see what happens the rest of the draft.
That was the blast.
Speaking of a blast and a draft. Draft.
Vanessa is just quoting you. Just happened.
I have no clue.
Vanessa's quoting you here. It took me a minute to see if you can see on the screen. Yes.
Oh.
She writes, please, in all caps. And then she writes, chocolate. But that's not what Meanie said. So for those of you who missed it, and give you an encouragement of why you need to join Patreon. So my wife sent me a text while we're live on the thing, and I couldn't text her back because we're using my phone to go live. And she writes, does Meanie want any birthday cake? Because my son just had his birthday, and we have a ton of cake left over. And I said, Meanie, you want some cake? And he yelled, yes. And then she asked, he yelled, please, because he's polite. And then she asked, would he like chocolate or vanilla? And he said yes.
He yelled yes.
Yes, and so that's what we got. That's
what Which got. Does no justice, but I don't want to startle my neighbors by screaming yes.
No, it's okay.
Going on over there.
Oh, man, yeah. You're like, no, I'm just live on the internet making a little extra money. Yeah, just yelling yes. No, but thank you all so much. This has been a This has been a blast. Pod Squad, thank you for tuning in again, and join us again next Monday and every Monday for another trip into the mind of the meaning. It's going to be episode 29. Bye now.
Bye.
Blue World Order. The world of MLW Radio never stops.